Back at it here. Spent the last several days trying to come up with more clarity to be more effective, more helpful. And so we've been able to do that, and time to advance the narrative even further here. What I'd like to suggest to everyone watching the video is that you are all teachers. I suggest you see yourself as a teacher, not as a pupil. There are no pupils here. It's not a situation of a teacher teaching students at all. It is a teacher sharing advice with other teachers. That's all. That's all there is. It's very crucial that you never see yourself as a student. There are no students here. Everyone in the world are teachers. And what we need to do from the standpoint of being teachers is we need to try and determine what is it we're trying to teach. What is the curriculum? All right? From that standpoint, then, you really have the leverage to, as a teacher, you have the right to focus on the curriculum and find out what's the purpose. What is it that you're trying to teach, right? Whereas from a student standpoint, you're just simply waiting to be fed by a teacher. You have no power or leverage at all to really look. But you, if you insist to know that you are a teacher, what is it that you're teaching? What is it you're trying to teach? And what is it you're trying to teach? What's the curriculum? How are you going about it, etc.? And that gives you then the opportunity to examine and say, okay, what's really going on here? What am I trying to teach? You feel empowered to look. You got the right to look. So the biggest step anyone can ever take is to say, okay, I'm a teacher. And just take that as you decided that is what you are. See, I'm not a student. And so that's the way I've always been. I always came here as a teacher and never saw myself as a student ever. And that in any situation, even with other, you know, great teachers, I never felt like I was somehow, you know, less than them as far as being, I'm just a student. I said, no, I'm a teacher and they're a teacher and they have some great advice for me. So I'm going to take that advice to heart, but not as a student, as a fellow teacher. So really in this world, we have this fellowship of teachers. The mail delivery person is coming here. So we'll see. I might tune it down for a second. We have a fellowship of teachers here in the world. We're all teachers. 1 minute. Okay. That one step would bring about a true revolution in the world. It would change. The situation would be completely put on a different footing. What we have right now through all the demagoguery that's going on the planet, demagoguery is to stir up the emotionalism, okay, and then to profit out of that emotionalism. When emotionalism is all stirred up, you lose your sense of being of reason. You lose your sense of being a teacher, and you feel like just a student that needs to be led somewhere. And then the demagogues lead you into aggrandizing themselves. We have a situation where the world is become demagogic. Demagoguery is everywhere. That is the mood of the times. Emotionalism is the mood of the times. Which is an extremely bad situation. It's what leads to global conflict. You have a whole bunch of demagogues, and then you have a whole bunch of just completely emotionalized entities here, and just, you know, pot is just bubbling over, foaming over. That is a recipe for disaster, because the demagogues are extremely narcissistic. And they require, see, the demagogue is someone who wants to have students, okay? Now, it happens in politics, it happens in spiritual teaching also. You can tell the difference between, for instance, let's say there's a politician who's not a demagogue. They trust in the reason of people and build that up and de-emphasize emotionalism. They don't bring up things that will stir up all sorts of emotionalism. They cool everything down. They're not there to serve. They're not there to be some leader of emotionalized people. Spiritual realm. there are those who want to be seen as a great teacher, guru, and everyone else is there to worship them, and they're you know, ignorant, stupid students. And then there are others who say, no, I'm just here as everyone is equal as far as their function as teachers, and just here to cool everything down. Don't bring up any emotionalism. There's no worship and all this awe and all this kind of stuff. And give, truly empower others. There's a difference there, a big difference. And the best empowerment I can tell you is that you are a teacher. You must accept your role. You are a teacher. And you may think, well, I don't have anything to teach. Ah, but as a teacher, don't you have to then consider what it is that you will teach and who it is that you're teaching to? What are you teaching? What's the curriculum? And then you start examining that, and you begin to clarify the whole situation here, and you see it as it is. Now, I've never been in awe around any teacher or any situation. I can't imagine myself being in awe of anyone. Because we are one spirit, right? Why should any aspect of spirit be in awe of another aspect of spirit? That is ridiculous. That just gives a wrong emphasis. I've had various situations being around a lot of teachers, some in the world and some on the subtle levels, and I was never in awe of any of them. Respect, listening, paying attention, yes. But feeling like I was somehow inferior, no, never, never. I just remembered this morning that my dad was a teacher of education, and he was a teacher of teachers. In other words, he held seminars all over, and he was in charge of helping other teachers be better teachers. That was his profession. I never really thought about that until now. And that is the orientation I have, is only towards other teachers, because ultimately we're all teachers. There's no such thing. None of us are students. It is ridiculous to try and place ourselves in a role of a student, like there's something that somehow we're inferior. You know, no, it's not true. Not true. As a teacher, again, you have to say, okay, who am I teaching? What am I teaching? How am I going to teach it? Is the learner capable of learning what I'm teaching? All this stuff you get to consider. You get to consider that, you see? Whereas if you're a student, you can't consider any of that at all. You might say, okay, what is the teacher going to teach me? And how am I going to learn it and stuff? But that's a different emphasis. It's really a different emphasis. Just one second here. All right. One more second. All right, stuff happens, and we have to keep right on trucking. So again, you are a teacher, and in examining the whole situation, you will discover what you need to discover. You will eventually unravel, because you're in a position of authority, right? You really are in a position of authority. We're all in a position of authority. Over what, see, is the question. Not over each other, no. We're not in a position. See, we share the fellowship of all being teachers, but what are we in authority over? That's the question. What's the student, you know? And is the student really capable of learning what we're trying to teach, is the question, right? The student is existence. It's nature, it's the universe, it's student. And the question is, can we, what is the purpose of existence? And can we teach existence to reach that purpose? That's the question. And you can ask those, as a teacher, you have the right to ask those questions, you see. Whereas a student, no, as a student, you align yourself with existence and just are waiting to be taught. You're not asking the pertinent questions at all. So, again, this is a gigantic leap forward for everybody. Is that everyone here, everyone on the planet, are teachers. We're all equal. We're all equal in that role of teachers. Now, there are some teachers who have figured it out, and so they're valuable advisors, but they're not, you know, superior at all. You know, nobody's superior like that. There's some that have no longer, you know, they're not struggling to figure it out. Sure, they finished with their considerations. So there is a distinction that way, and it's a useful distinction, but not a superiority. They're not to be worshipped or nothing awful, in awe or anything like that. No way. And no, never place yourself in a position of, oh, I'm a student. That is wrong. When you're listening to anyone, any teacher, listen as you yourself are a teacher also. Okay? And as a teacher, you realize you have something very important you have to figure out, really, because you're struggling to teach, right? You think there's something weird here in existence. There's something isn't right. It doesn't seem like I'm able to teach very well here. Why? The question is why. So you're listening to other teachers. You know, what have they gleaned like that? And the better you can listen and pay attention quietly, the better it is, you see. But not as a student. No, absolutely not. Now, of course, we're trying to teach existence something, actually. We're trying to teach existence how to teach us to be prime creators. That is the situation we're in, you see. So what we're doing is we're trying to put existence above us as the teacher and us as the student. You see, that is all wrong, because we are the ones who are trying to teach existence how to teach us, but we're still the teachers. Okay, it's a interesting duality there, isn't it? We're trying to teach existence how to teach us. How can we be prime creator? Okay, how can we be prime creators? And we're giving existence all these tools and all these dynamics and all this stuff, which would then can be brought back to bear upon us, you see. But us as what? As bodies, as personalities, etc. So literally the chain is, we as spirit are trying to teach existence how to teach bodies, people, personalities, how they can, there's the question. It is this loop, but the fact is we are in control. We're the teachers who are teaching existence, and existence is trying to teach us the way, teach us the way, show us the way, how we can be prime creator. And it does it through loss. Destruction of bodies and things and all energy patterns breaking down, right? And our plan is, I've said in many other videos, our plan is to use this supposed power of loss then to force the prime creator to change reality for us and make us prime creator. But we are the ones who are in control of this. We are the teachers. We're the ones who are trying to teach existence something, you know. And the thing is that we haven't been able to do this. And so we're thinking that there's something wrong with us, you know, our teaching capacity. There's something flawed. And then we think, well, we're just not good enough learners. But how can we really teach existence to accomplish this? And is it that we are not good learners, or that existence cannot learn, is incapable? How can we teach how to accomplish the impossible? In other words, that's another question you can ask yourself as a teacher. You have the right to ask that question. How can I teach anything how to accomplish the impossible? is that really possible? Can I really teach that? So you put yourself in a position of teacher, and then from that standpoint, it's easy to then translate that back into, okay, I can set the whole teaching learning thing down and pick up a different cause where I am the pure experiencer of reality once again, instead of needing to teach or learn anything. You set the whole teaching learning thing down, but you can't do that from the standpoint of the learner. You're not in a position to determine that. It's only from the position of the teacher that you're in a position to make that discernment, you see? Because the pupil is just waiting on the teacher to get to teach better. But you as a teacher are looking at the pupil saying, can the pupil really learn what I'm teaching? Can I teach existence how to generate a power that can destroy reality? Can I teach existence that? That is the question. And so as a teacher, you can say, aha, maybe I cannot teach that, you see. And then you're in a position to say, okay, class dismissed. The pupil can't dismiss class, right? The pupils are in their chairs waiting for the bell ring, but the teacher is the one who dismisses the class. So we're all waiting for some authority, you know, waiting for the teacher that we think is not us to tell us what to do. But the teacher is the one who's looking at the students saying, hey, you know what? No matter what I do, these students cannot learn the lesson because I'm trying to teach them how to generate a power of destructivity, a power of loss that can actually threaten the prime creator into changing reality. And as a teacher, you can evaluate it and you start to see, wait a minute, maybe this isn't possible. Maybe it's not possible. When you see it's not possible, then you can say, okay, class dismissed. Permanently dismissed. And see, as a teacher, you have the right to dismiss the class, right? You can say, okay, class over. You have the right to do that. But you have to place yourself in a position where you have the right to do what needs to be done, dismiss the class. Say, okay, guess what, class dismissed. You don't have to explain, class dismissed. That's it, because you know, I was only using existence to try to create a power over reality. A power that we could go to the Prime Creator and say, Prime Creator, we have this new power that you didn't create. We created it. We learned how to create it. And now we are telling you that you must change reality for us a little bit, or else we're going to annihilate all of reality. So, you know, that's what we're trying to accomplish. We're trying to learn that. We're trying to teach it. We're trying to teach existence how to manufacture this power. And existence can't do it. So we keep thinking, you know, hey, you know, existence needs to, we need to be better teachers, and existence needs to be a better learner. And so we pretend to be learners and try in this world, and we try to give examples to existence how to learn better, you know, better, be a better student. But that places ourselves under the authority of, you know, of this, in a position where we can't dismiss the class is the problem. I remember being called into this world, and everyone's saying, we're stuck in this horrible dilemma, which is true. We're on the horns of this terrible dilemma. On one hand, we fear our destruction and death and sickness. On the other hand, we fear being excluded from the new reality we think we're going to create, and therefore being annihilated. So we're, on one hand's annihilation, the other hand's death. It's the horns of a dilemma. It's all fear, and everybody's freaking out here, so fearful. So from the subtle realms, which are also still not enlightened, you get pulled down into this world to try and help. And then I came down here, and I tried to be a really good student, you know, say, what's the problem here? I know everybody's having problems learning here. So I tried to show how to be a really good student. But in doing that, you lose the position of clarity as a teacher, where you can, teacher, you simply dismiss the class. You see, as a student, you can't dismiss the class. You're involved in trying to learn how to be a better student. And that's the wrong position. That's the wrong position to get in. But that's what everybody here is assuming. The problem is that they're not good enough students. They're not good enough at learning. And they call it all sorts of terms like the spiritual path, you know, evolution, progress. It is, we need to somehow evolve more. As students, we need to evolve more. But as a teacher, you say, now, wait a minute. You know, what's really going on here with this classroom? So if you put yourself in that position, it's all different. You have a different perspective. And it's really essential that you do that. So, and you can do it. I've done it. It's not an arrogant thing at all. It's a truth-based thing, because we really are spirit trying to teach existence how to create this power of negation, so that then we can threaten the prime creator with that power. So we all are trying to teach existence how to do this, and we don't know how to do it. So we're all kind of, that's why we talk about evolution of consciousness, progress, all this stuff, because that's just a code. That's just code for saying we're not sure how to do this. We're not sure why. As teachers, why? Question it, because it can't be done, is the answer. And eventually, you know, we see that maybe it can't be done. But as a teacher, you can question that. As a student, you don't dare to do that, right? As a student, you feel it's essential, because you think you don't want to be excluded from the new reality. So you want to be a good learner, and so you're in the position. You're in a very, very bad position if you see yourself as a student. Very bad, hopeless situation, really. You say, "Well, I want to be a better student. I want to be a better student." That's a hopeless situation in this world. On the horns of this dilemma, to be a better student, existence will tell you you have to suffer more death, more disease, more fear. If you want to be a good student, you have to suffer more fear. And if you say you don't like that fear, then you feel the threat of being excluded, disloyal to the plan, and feel threat of being excluded from the new reality. In other words, threat of annihilation. So you, every time you feel complain about this loss and fear, you feel even worse threat of being annihilated. So it's like a vicious circle in existence as a student. But as a teacher, you're on the level saying, how can this situation be taught? And you become aware of what the curriculum is. Saying, you can say, okay, I'm trying to teach existence how to develop a power of loss through all this suffering and death and change. And I want to use this loss, this power of negation, to threaten the prime creator to change reality. So we, you know, spirit can be prime creator. You say, okay, that is what I'm trying to teach. You can clarify. And then you say, okay, now, is this possible? You can ask the question, is this possible? And then you can say, you know, okay, let me look at that. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. But at least you're in a position to look at it and say, let me check in with this. Because you're the one, you feel responsible. You need to teach this. You know what you're trying to teach. And so you say, well, is it teachable? Because really, existence is just a puppet, you know. It's just something that's very like a puppet. We're just pulling the strings, trying to get existence to come up with it, because we can't come up with it. See, here's kind of the thing about it. We as spirit realize the deep level, we cannot come up with this power of negation. So we are relying on existence, which is a hypothetical scenario, to come up with this power. To develop it somehow. So it's like we're like dependent on existence to develop this power. And we are guiding it and giving advice and all this, you know, stuff, trying to teach it how to do it. But we ourselves can't do it. So it's a very interesting situation. We're trying to, again, we want to be prime creator. We had this idea, we wanted to be prime creator. We realized we can't change reality at all. And then we said, well, the only other option is that the prime creator can change it. But we couldn't get the prime creator to change it. Prime creator said, cannot change it. So we said, how are we gonna get the prime creator to change it? And we said, okay. So we said, well, can we, is there something we can do? Can we threaten the prime creator? No, we cannot. Prime Creators, we realize there's no threat. We have no power to threaten the Prime Creator with, nothing to threaten the Prime Creator with. So we said, okay, what do? Okay, we'll dream up, we'll imagine a hypothetical scenario. And this hypothetical scenario is manufacturing a new power of negation. And that this hypothetical scenario of imagination will be able to create, manufacture this a new power. So that's why you have history, time, space. That's all this process. We believe there's some kind of process that can generate, create a new power that Prime Creator didn't create. And then once this new power is generated, and of course we're the ones who are imagining all this, then we will have as it like in our hands, so to speak, to threaten the Prime Creator with this new power. But we're dependent on this hypothetical imaginary scenario we call existence, time and space and process, to generate this power. We can't do it ourselves, but we're in the role of like advisor, teacher, saying, okay, you know, we need to do this and this, and we've established these. Since we're the dreamers, we're the imaginers, we're the ones imagining what's going on, as it were. And we're kind of like rooting existence on. Come on, existence, come on, come on, come on. You can do it, you can do it, you can do it. You need more bodies? Sure, here, you know, let's make more bodies. And so, you know, the dream is dependent on the dreamer. Isn't that true? It is true, even though it doesn't seem that way. Once the dream is there, it seems like the dream is independent of the dreamer. So we feel like existence is independent of us, but it's not really. And as a teacher, you know, we can evaluate existence and saying, is it learning? Is it learning what I want it to learn? That is the thing. See, we are the ones that have the curriculum. See, the teacher is the one that establishes the curriculum, right? We establish the curriculum of existence, generating this power, manufacturing it somehow. And we think that all the loss and death that's ever occurred throughout the history of the cosmos, all the change, all of that, it is a process of generating this power of negation. We believe it. We believe it. And so we are telling existence, you know, you're getting there. What I mean by teacher is like that. We establish the curriculum and we continue to push the curriculum. You know, although we don't have to, right? We can also say, class dismissed. I no longer hold on to this curriculum. I've chosen a different curriculum, which is simply to not try and change reality at all, not try to threaten Prime Creator, which then would generate a different curriculum, right? As I say, it'd be the overlay, unconditional love, that would generate that. If we place ourselves as a student, then we are placing ourselves with the process of existence. And we feel we're identifying with the process. Okay, it's a matter of identifying. We end up identifying with existence. The sickness, the dying, the bodies, the change, the process, the continual process of loss, of negation, which is what existence is. We identify with that to try and make it real. Okay, we're trying to make it real. Feel that by placing ourselves, identifying as if we were the subject of this process, subjecting ourselves to this process of loss, as if we are teaching existence how to do it. See, so how are we teaching? We're teaching by imagining that our identity is subjected to all this loss, when in fact it's not. If you put yourself in the position of teacher, you know, your identity is not subjecting itself to all this loss. This loss is just a dream. It has nothing to do with our identity at all. So the position of teacher is the position of awakening, is the position of realization, is the position of choosing a different cause, choosing a new idea, and that way of being reconciling oneself back with reality as it is, instead of trying to threaten reality. Whereas if we identify with all this loss, and you know what we're doing is we're trying to encourage existence. Come on, come on, come on. You can do it. It's like a dream. We're dreaming a dream and we place ourselves in the dream and we're being chased and beaten up and killed by the figures in the dream to encourage them, to show them, look how powerful they are. You know, look, you can even destroy the dreamer. That's what we're doing. As we identify with bodies, with people, with worlds, with the universe, we are literally trying to encourage the dream figures. Saying, look, 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 you see, keep going. Look, look, you can even destroy me. You can destroy me. You can do it. That is what's going on. Whereas we could also, if we were, you know, just not place ourselves in the dream at all. And then, of course, if we did that, we might say, well, how do we know that existence is building up this power of negation if we don't test it out on ourselves? But remember, we're testing it out on bodies. So it's a huge jump to say what our self is, what our identity is actually a body. See? In other words, we're trying to say that existence is developing this power of negation because, and the proof is that it can destroy bodies. See, that's the proof we think. But of course, in order to believe that, we have to then believe that our identity really is created by a body, that somehow our identity is dependent on a body. See, but we're only doing that, imagining this. It's just imagining this, sort of just decreeing it for ourselves, like it's a belief. We're just believing this. There's no truth to it whatsoever, but we're believing it in order to, for us to say, wow, existence really is powerful, really can destroy us. And therefore we say, aha, if it can destroy us, that the Prime Creator, we're one with the Prime Creator, then it certainly can also destroy the Prime Creator in reality, see? So literally, by identifying ourselves with the body, in the world, in the dance of process, which is all our own imagination, we imagined all this process, we're literally saying that we're trying to believe that we have the power to destroy reality and threaten the Prime Creator. That is why we identify with bodies. That's the why of it. And as a teacher, we can say, wait a minute, is this what I really want to teach? Is this true? Am I teaching truth? See? Or am I teaching belief? This is just belief I've made up belief. As a teacher, you can say, wait a minute, right? A student just has to sit there and listen to what a teacher says, but the teacher can say, wait a minute, do I really want to teach this, right? Do I really want to identify with process? Because in doing so, I'm literally trying myself, I'm trying to believe that what I am can be destroyed, see? Now, of course, we know deep down, we know it's a trick, that we're not really a body. But we are testing out the waters, as it were. We dip our foot in the water of existence and we say, oh, wow, this body can be destroyed. I feel all the fear and vulnerability of this body. So that means that existence probably has the power, or is getting close. So we keep testing it, you know, to see how destructive is existence right now. And there's 7 billion people in the world right now who are testing the waters. And they're realizing, my gosh, you know, we are totally threatened here. Totally threatened. And we take that as saying, wow, existence really, really does have the power. See, we're boosting our belief. And we're boosting our teachings. We're thinking, okay, our teachings really are taking root here. You know. But we forget our role, our true role as teacher, what we're trying to do by identifying with this. Now, but if we can knock that off and say, wait a minute, let's not stay in the role of learner here. subjected to, identity subjected to process and change and all, and vulnerability and threat. Let's get back to the role of teacher, okay? Then you're in a whole different situation. Whole different situation. You're no longer trying to determine how successful existence is in developing this power of destructivity. You're now asking, wait a minute, is this whole thing valid in the first place? Because you say, wait a minute, I'm not really a body, so all this evidence is not really genuine evidence at all. And you start thinking, do I want to keep teaching this? Do I want to hold on to this curriculum? Do I want to try and keep testing this out on bodies, thinking that I'm testing it out on myself when I'm really not? Do I want to keep doing that? And so you're in a position of choice then. As a teacher, you're in a position of choice where you can choose. Okay, where if you just think that you're a learner, a body, your identity is that of a body and a pupil and a learner, and you're trying to learn about loss, learn about threat, you don't feel any power to make a choice like that. What we're talking about here, make a choice of, do I really want to continue on with this, what I see as a charade? Not in that position. You don't feel empowered to do that. So you don't have to bow to anybody in this world. You don't have to feel that way. You have to hold your head up. Hold your head up. Because the greatest teacher there's ever been is none other than your own self, is spirit, which is what you are. You're not less at all. It's just that you're identifying yourself as a body, as that which can be threatened, in order to ascertain how well this plan is going, how well your curriculum is going, of developing this power of negation. And in doing that, of course, you're going to feel like, as if you are threatened, whereas those who are not doing that, they feel no threat at all. And then you feel like worshiping them, you know, like they're superior to what you are. But that's not the point. The point is for you to see yourself as them, in that same position of the one who can choose which idea to experience. And you can say, wait a minute, all of this arose from the idea of trying to be prime creator. This whole scenario of trying to generate loss arose from that. And you can say, well, how about just choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator? Then what kind of scenario arises from that? Unconditional love, seamless peace, you know, arises from that. Because there's no desire to generate any loss at all. No threat. No desire to generate threat. Okay. We're trying to threaten the prime creator. How do we do that? How do we determine how successful we are? How far along are we? By identifying as a body and then feeling the threat and saying, aha, you know, we're really very advanced, very far along. So right now in this world here, identifying with a body, we can believe that we're very far along in our effort to manufacture negation. Because, you know, this whole planet, we can feel it's going to be negated. We can feel the planetary sacrifice is coming. And so we think, wow, existence is, we've really done a great job in building up this power of negation, and we're almost finished. That's why everyone's here on this planet identifying as a body. That is why. But there are some are saying, whoa, wait a minute. You don't have to go through all this loss. You don't have to identify with any of this loss. Because this is not possible to, we don't have the power to create the power of negation. We don't have the power to create a power at all. We're not created to create. God, prime creator, created all the powers of reality. We don't have the ability, and our imagination doesn't have the ability, and a hypothetical scenario doesn't have the ability. Therefore, all of this loss is a waste of time. And then you don't have to identify. You don't have to say, wait a minute, I am a body that is threatened. Basically, all bodies are inherently threatened, as it were. But you don't even have to identify with the body. You don't even have to see what you are as a body at all. It's optional, and it's just belief-based. In truth, you're not a body, but you have the option to believe you are. But you exercise that option only to assess threat. That's it. And you assess threat only because you want to see how your teaching is coming along, how your effort to generate a power of negation over reality is coming along. That's how it goes. And as a teacher, you can say, wait a minute, is this what I really want to teach? You see? Do I want to, you realize you're trying to teach yourself how to annihilate yourself. I really want to keep teaching that when I know it's futile. And it's important to pay attention now at this time to this, because this this display of the power of negation is about ready to take place. Existence puts on these displays. We demand that it is so. I mean, just the very fact we demand that the mind find a way means the mind has to generate all of this. And existence will generate massive displays of loss, of negation, of death and dying and all of that in order to pump up the belief that we're really getting somewhere. To strengthen the belief that, yeah, we're almost there. We almost got it. And we're at it. We're at the crossroads where that is due, scheduled to take place now. And the question is, why pump up your faith in what eventually you must deflate that belief? You must deflate that to belief because it's a futile belief. We'll never succeed in what we're trying to teach. We're trying to teach existence how to destroy reality, how to negate reality, and placing ourselves on the railroad tracks, you know, tying ourselves to the railroad tracks and getting run over by the train, and then saying, you see, existence, you can do it. You can do it. You destroyed me. And of course, you just destroyed a proxy, a symbol. Doesn't have any bearing on what we really are at all. So this is all just like a charade. Existence is really a charade. The torture chamber, it is a charade. It is something we have simply, it's a castle made of sand. And we don't have to keep doing it if we choose as teachers what is that we want to teach. We can also choose to teach not trying to be prime creator. We can teach that to ourselves, really. We're trying to teach, you know, we can teach that and say, okay, how do we teach that? And what kind of student arises? Unconditional love arises as the student of that idea that what we're trying to teach. And then we say, this is a perfect student. He's already learned a lesson. It's really like, you know, you're in a teacher and the student's a new year. Students come into a classroom and you look and you determine, what kind of class do I have this year? And my mom was a teacher also, and every year she'd have new classrooms. And she'd say, oh boy, you know, come back and say, wow, I really got a doozy of a class this year. And some years, you know, it'd be really good. They said, I have really great students. Other years, terrible. So I was like, we're waiting. What kind of classroom do we have in existence? And I said, oh my gosh, very unruly class, you know. How can I, this is terrible. All these students, they're not interested. They can't learn. They're not, you know, horrible. Existence is like a classroom full of malcontents who simply, you know, cannot learn. They're not interested. Whereas choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to develop a power of loss, of negation. Who comes into our classroom when we're trying to teach that? The perfect student. Student comes in. Students are like, perfect. They already know what you want to teach them. And you just sit there and you say, wow. You already know. You pass. You know, you've A+. I'll give you an A+ right now. Because you already know it. Perfect student. The perfect student. The overlay is the perfect student. Unconditional love is the perfect student. And you as teacher just simply, all you have to do is smile and just say, yeah. That's exactly how I want to feel, that I'm the perfect student, perfect teacher, and then that can be translated back into total reconciliation with the functioning of reality. When you feel you're the perfect teacher and you've had the perfect student, and then you can just set both the teacher and the student down at that point. Whereas now we're struggling with this horrible classroom, and we're so upset, and they say, I'm a terrible teacher, and my students are terrible, I can't get them to learn, and I must be a failure. And how do you translate that back into perfect reconciliation with reality? You cannot translate that. It would be completely abrupt, abrupt change, wouldn't it? There's no common ground between the reality and the attempt to create the power of threat and loss of negation. There's no common ground there at all. Whereas if you're the perfect teacher and they have the perfect student, and you're simply resting and abiding in that, then that's easily translatable. So unconditional love, this perfect overlay, is the perfect student who comes into your classroom, already knows the answer, what you're trying to teach, knows exactly what you're trying to teach, and is perfectly aligned with it and says, yeah, I get it. And then you just sit there looking at the student saying, I wonder if they're going to waver. And you just sit there and they never waver. Never waver. And you just say, wow, I guess I am the perfect teacher. Yeah. And then from that point, you say, okay, I'm a perfect teacher. I get the idea of perfection. Perfect teacher, perfect student, perfection, flawlessness, etc. All that is easily translatable into reality. Easily. Whereas the point we're at now, again, there is no easy translation at all. It would be completely abrupt shift. Completely abrupt. Night and day. It's as if you're going from pitch darkness into, total light. That's not something that we're reconciled to that at all. So we really do have to choose a different cause, choose a different curriculum, choose a different classroom, right? Say, this is my new curriculum, and then see what student shows up for that curriculum, and that student will be unconditional love, will show up as the student, not as the teacher, as the student. You remain as the teacher. You're the one who's establishing the curriculum. We as spirit chose the idea of trying to be prime creator, and we as spirit then are responsible. We have to choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. We have to pick it. We chose the cause of existence. Now we have to choose the cause of reconciliation with reality. It's up to us. We have to do that. So again, we must see ourselves in that position of choice. And a student really is not in a position of choice. They may think, they can bully the teacher or something. No, that's not the right position to be in. So, from what we've gone over in this video, I'm seeing a great breakthrough. Because when unconditional love arrives, when this incredible experience arrives, it arrives as the student. And you as the teacher, you don't bow down to it. Because it's bowing down to you. That is the true relationship. It's an effect. It's cause doesn't bow down to effect. Effect bows down to cause. Okay, we're spirit. We're cause of our experience. We choose ideas. Of course, but we didn't create ourselves. So we do bow down to the prime creator. Okay. But how do we bow? By functioning as the prime creator created us to function. Okay. Which is to choose and experience ideas. And so when this unconditional love arrives as the new pupil, your new student, you recognize it as the perfect student, but it's still a student, you see. You are still the teacher. And from that relationship, then you can accept it. You see, it's a whole different relationship now we're talking about. You're not there to bow down to the student, as it were, or to switch places or anything like that. You're simply there to acknowledge, say, okay, class is in session, and appreciate the perfect student. Saying, of course, as a teacher, you can say, wow, I'm so happy that you're here. The perfect student is here. But the relationship is in a correct, cause and effect is in a correct relationship there. Okay? You absolutely do deserve it because you're the teacher and you're the one established the curriculum that brought this perfect student in to your classroom. You're the one that did it. So you absolutely deserve it. This is all important, because from this standpoint, you really can get it. You can be free. You can free yourself from their unruly classroom and instead have the perfect student in your classroom, which is what you really want. You don't really want to continue teaching this unruly class because they're like beating the teacher up constantly. You know, they're building piñatas of the teacher and whacking the teacher and knocking the stuffing out of it, you know. Existence keeps building bodies, and you keep identifying with them, saying, okay, beat, you know, destroy this body, and existence destroys it, you know, and you keep doing that over and over, trying to teach these students how to really develop this power of negation. That's what's taking place. But again, you don't really want that unruly classroom. Who never really learn, who continuously unruly, and continuously keep beating up these bodies, you know, making bodies and beating them up. You don't really want that classroom. You really want the perfect student to come in your classroom. But again, in order to be not overwhelmed by that, you are the teacher. It's your classroom. And the perfect student arrives because you chose a new curriculum to teach. That is why. So it's not overwhelming. I'm trying to, this is the most important thing we can really talk about now, because we've sort of laid the foundation, the situation. Yeah, there is this big situation of loss coming up, vulnerability, threat, a loss, in order to pump up the belief that we're succeeding in developing this power of negation. That is coming for sure. So we know that, and then we know what the remedy is to choose a new idea, etc. But what we're afraid of really is being overwhelmed by this. If we can imagine coming across, you know, something that is just perfect, we're afraid, oh, we're just going to collapse and be overwhelmed by it. And so we have to address this situation. How we can simply allow the situation to arise. Perfect student arise in our classroom. How do we handle that? Because that is what we literally, that is our option. There's two options. We can continue on trying to assess the power of negation and putting ourselves in threatening situations and loss and death and all that, or we can choose to have the perfect student walk into our classroom. Those are the only two options we have. So we have to seriously consider having the perfect student walk into our classroom. And how do we, you know, deal with that situation? That is, if you ask what do I spend my time on, that is what I spend my time on. The perfect student walks into your classroom. And you're flawless. And what do? And if we can address this question, we are literally on the brink of success, of really what we really want. We're on the brink of what we really want. And we're asking the right questions because we've cleared everything else out, okay? Everything else has been cleared out, and yet there's this one remaining stumbling block of this perfect student walking to our classroom, and what do? We say, oh my, do we worship the student? No. We have to see the right relationship to the student, to the perfect student. It's all important. Cause is not worshiping effect. Effects complete cause, okay? Without the effects, cause can't be a real cause, because effects complete the cause. A cause without any effects is not a cause at all. But on the same hand, a cause is primary, and effects are secondary, what complete the cause. So you, a spirit, as far as your prime creator created you like itself, in other words, as a causal agent. So you choose ideas. That's being a causal agent. Mind presents the ideas. That's secondary. That completes the cause. You then, as a teacher, are primary. You establish the curriculum. This unconditional love, the perfect student, is secondary. It's an effect that completes the cause, that completes the curriculum. But you're still primary in that situation. Okay. So you can keep your poise. See, that is all important. There are certain teachers that can help us with that. There are certain examples that can help us with that. Because that is the entire situation we're at right now. We're on the brink. We're on the brink of the abyss. And we do have this option, and we can accept this option, but we do need to address this one situation of what do we do when the perfect student arrives in our classroom. My belief is that one of the teachers, Ananda Maima, played the role of the perfect student, because she never said she was a teacher. She always said she was just a little girl, and she called everyone else like father or mother, and she said, no, I'm nothing but a little girl. And she played the role of the perfect student here for us and gave us an opportunity to get to feel what would a perfect student be like. You see, gave us that opportunity. So I tapped into that. I somehow got a hold of that and said, wow, because she never really played the role of the teacher. Not really. I mean, everyone tried to cast her in that role, and she'd always say, no, I'm just this little girl. Just a little girl. So happy to see you. I'm so happy to see you. It's like unconditional love put a body on, The perfect student wrapped itself up in a body and appeared in this world to give us the opportunity to relate to the perfect student. That's how I see it. Very unusual situation. She never, wrote anything, never, any planned talks or anything. She just kind of interrelated with people, but always in a way to kind of remind them, hey, you're the teacher. You're the one establishing the curriculum. I'm playing the role of the perfect student for you so that you can get the right relationship and get used to what is it like for a perfect student to come in your classroom. And we have to be able to do that. We have to be able to have unconditional love be the effect that we're experiencing, that we are experiencing. We're not a product of that. Okay, we're the cause of it. We're the cause of it. And it completes the circle of cause and effect for us, but we're primary. What Ananda Maima did was she acted like when she'd go to religious teachers, she always go to religious teachers, and she'd sit there like a student. She'd just sit there very calmly in the back of the room or something, like a student. She didn't want to be the role of the teacher at all. You know, they insisted, but she said, no, 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 no. You teach. You teach. You're the teachers. I'm the student. I'm the student. And of course, everybody's kind of like thrown for a loop, you know. She said, you're a student. You don't need to learn. What are you talking about? You should be the great teacher. She goes, no, 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 Father. I'm just a little student. In other words, the effect unconditional love is the student, is the perfect student. But we, Spirit, are the teachers. We are primary. So we have to accept the perfect student. And people really struggled with that. And they kept saying, no, we want to push you up. And you're the greatest teacher. You teach us. She'd say, no, 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 no. You're the teacher. You teach me. You know. And they'd say, well, we don't need to teach you. You know everything. And she'd say, okay. You know, they had to consider, wait a minute, what's going on here? How did I get this perfect student in my classroom? You know, they had to start that consideration, you see. It's very important. So some of the greatest situation that could arise for us, really, is for the perfect student to show up, you know, in this world. It already did once with Anandamayi. Showed up, the perfect student showed up. You know, I don't know if the perfect student will show up again in this world. I really don't know. But that is supremely helpful, because we'd understand the situation. That perfect student wouldn't be up there on a throne teaching us. That perfect student would be in the audience saying, you teach, you know, you're the teacher. And we'd have to accept it, you see? Instead of saying, no, 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 you're perfect, you teach us. The perfect student would say, no, I'm just the perfect student, but you're the perfect teacher, you see? Because you established the curriculum. That's the ultimate teacher right there. The one who puts themselves in the role of the perfect student is really the ultimate teacher. Because then that really puts things in the right relationship, that we have to then accept that we're the perfect teacher. In order to have the perfect student, we must be the perfect teacher, right? And so for the perfect teacher, what is it that we're teaching? And we must be teaching that reality as it is cannot be changed, because that's truth. We must be teaching truth. And the lesson must be incredibly simple and easy to learn, right? Yeah, that is so. So the struggle we're at right now, we have some tools to work with. The struggle we're at is, again, if a perfect teacher shows up, I'm sorry, if a perfect student shows up, the perfect student shows up, we cannot kowtow and bow to them and say, oh, let us put you on the throne. And that would be complete misuse of the situation, complete misuse of it. They'll say, no, 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 we're the teachers. Okay. We have a perfect student now. What is it that we must be teaching to have that perfect student show up? Let's be aware of that. And then just sit there and abide in that, you know. And I feel I have that capability to do that, because I've spent my life focusing on that. And you don't surrender and say, oh, you know, oh, I'm inferior. You know, you here, perfect student, you teach the class. No, that's not the role of the perfect student. The role of the perfect student is to be the perfect student and to remain as that and as abide as that, and give you us the opportunity to recognize that we're the perfect teacher also. And then with the perfect teacher, perfect student, the entire thing easily translated back into complete, flawless reconciliation with reality. We're no longer trying to threaten the Prime Creator, trying to develop a power threat. So this is a tremendous day today. What is it today? The 25th of August. 25th of August, yeah. The 27th of August is the 30th anniversary of Anandamayi Ma passing on at the age of, 86, back in 1982, August 27th, she passed on. The perfect student passed from this world. We have to pass from this world, but the fact the world kept insisting she be a teacher, and that caused her body to age and asked her to pass away. She said that is, you know, It's what you want. So it was a, it was, we didn't see it in the right perspective at that time. Some did, a few did maybe, but most did not. But if we can see that the role of the perfect student in the right perspective, it's a whole different ball game. You see, it's a whole different ball game for us. And maybe the 30th anniversary of the perfect student dropping the body here, maybe something will happen, a birthday blessing will happen in this world, if we can recognize the purpose of that. And up until this day, I hadn't spoken that out directly in the world, because I was kind of intimidated by all those who looked up to her as the greatest teacher ever, you know. And that was really a complete misunderstanding of her role. Reverse things. And see, all she could do was smile, you know, and just say, well, I'm still the perfect student. And everyone kept saying, no, you're the perfect teacher. And she'd just say, no, I'm just the perfect student. And it kind of got to loggerheads, you know, and just didn't. It's hard for us to see it. Really tough, but we can do it. We can do it. I know I can do it. And since I can do it, I know you can do it. We have the capability within ourselves to see clearly. The problem was, if you have the perfect student, most people come and say, how can you possibly be acting as the teacher when you have someone who's so much better than you? You must be arrogant, egotistical, crazy, etc. And you should make them the teacher and you're the student. In other words, they completely try to reverse the situation and lose all effectiveness because of that. So you must stand firm. You must stand firm. You must be adamant and say, no. This, the utility of the situation is that they are the perfect student, and that gets us to then be realize that we're the perfect teacher. We have to choose a perfect curriculum, right? How can we have a perfect student if we don't have a perfect curriculum? It's not possible. So if a perfect student arrives, it must be that they know, you know, that we are going to choose the perfect curriculum, that we already have that in our mind. We just need to have the will to do it. We need to, you know, decide, okay, once and for all, we're going to choose a perfect curriculum. The curriculum of trying to develop a power of negation over reality is not a perfect curriculum, because it can never be realized. So it's an imperfect curriculum. In fact, it's an impossible curriculum. If we have an impossible curriculum, how can we have a perfect student? How can we have a perfect student? We cannot. Our students are going to be crazy. But choose a perfect curriculum, you have a perfect student. Perfect student, you see? I'm very hopeful at this time that we're going to get a big boost, and it will come in the form of a perfect student. That's the only way it can come, really. A perfect teacher, how's a teacher perfect without a perfect student, you know? It's the perfect student that points to the perfect teacher, you see. And when the perfect student shows up in a world, we then have the opportunity to reconcile ourselves and realize that, you know, there must be a perfect curriculum. There must be a perfect curriculum, right? And we, the teacher, as teachers, we then must have the ability to choose a perfect curriculum. See, it's a powerful, powerful opportunity. And there has to be those who insist that it remain in the right context like this, and I will certainly do that. I don't bow to anybody, you know. I respect all, everyone, we're all teachers in this world. I respect everyone equally, really, in that regard. But I don't bow to anybody, and I don't bow to the perfect student. I welcome the perfect student, you know. And together, the perfect teacher, the perfect student, the perfect curriculum, all that together then gets translated and back. We are easily translated back to reality, back to reconciliation, genuine reconciliation. That's how it works. So I'm very hopeful. I'm very hopeful that somehow we get a perfect student in this world. Really, I've not seen one yet in this world. I've been looking for one, haven't found one at all. No way. But right. It is possible. It happened at least once. Ananda my ma, 1896, came into the world in perfect student. The perfect student. Flawless student. Must have come from a flawless curriculum, you see. And again, she's here to serve us. That's all. She said, just here to serve you. Perfect student. Not to teach, but to serve us as the perfect student. Meaning, she must believe that we can choose a perfect curriculum. She said, I have absolute belief you can choose a perfect curriculum. That's why I'm here. If you couldn't, why would I even show up here in the first place? You see? Why? Be just a gesture of futility. Be ridiculous. So, I'm telling you, the Prime Creator knows that you can choose a perfect curriculum. The grace of the Prime Creator functions by sending a perfect student into the world that reaffirms the Prime Creator knows, says, yes, you can choose a perfect curriculum. Very simple. Just choose the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator. Done. Done deal. That simple. Choose a new cause. Pick up a new cause. Choose a new idea. That's what I've been saying for years and years and years now. And preparing for the appearance of a perfect student, really. Will one appear? I don't know. I don't know. But that's the highest, the best teaching opportunity possible, really. If you can see it in the right context. I certainly can. And you can too. You know, just the fact that you're listening to these videos means something in you is preparing for the right context. You know, the right context. From the viewers, all the responses I've gotten here, there's something really good going on here. Because the responses have been pretty much on target, you know, as far as there's like a feeling like something's going on here. I'm trying to get it, you know. It's not trying to build me up or anything like that. You know, there's nothing. The dynamic here is a good one, you know, that I've experienced with these, which is why I keep making these videos. Is we're all preparing for something here, for opportunity. You know, we're not trying to elevate each other and one bows to another and all that kind of stuff. We're preparing for an opportunity and to respond to the opportunity in the right way. That's how I see it. And all of us, when we all, each one of us can choose a perfect curriculum, which will bring the perfect student, which will bring, realize we're a perfect teacher, and that will be translated into reality. We will all do that at some point. We can all do that right now, as a matter of fact, if we see it this way. And we can see it that way. We can also, if we choose, not see it that way. It's up to us. But by not seeing it that way, we will... There's a reason why the Nazis were called Nazis. Not seeing. Not see. You know, I can choose to not see. It means not seeing. Okay. Yeah. Not seeing. We can choose to not see it that way, and then we are going to be enmeshed in the Nazis. Okay. That was just a rehearsal. World War II is just a dress rehearsal for what's coming. And, you know, the push of not seeing brings about this, again, experiencing loss and vulnerability, threat, destruction, negation, all this stuff, assessing how well we've developed this power of negation. We have to assess it. You know, we have to keep pushing that agenda. Terrible. You know, it's not what we really want. It's not what anyone on this planet really wants. It's what they think they want. They don't really want it. They believe they want it. They believe that, well, I must assess this threat. I must see how we're doing, blah, blah, blah. But it's not what they really want. What they really want is to be reconciled with reality. And the way to do that is to have the perfect student show up and then realize there must be a perfect curriculum and then realize you must have the capability to choose a perfect curriculum and then to choose it. And then the whole thing then is easily translated back. Reconciliation with reality. That is what we really want. It's what we really want. So, it's an auspicious time now. It's very auspicious. I've been feeling like there's something very auspicious coming up. And I just a couple days ago, I just kind of came across a blurb on Ananda my ma and realized she passed away on August 27th. Actually, I saw a video of her ma samadhi, of her passing away and her lifeless body, a squirrel dropping walnut, and it said, you know, passed away August 27th. I said, oh yeah. And I said, oh my gosh, that a few days. I've been intensely focusing on her life, all the circumstances of her life, trying to get the big picture, because all the little stuff drives me crazy, you know, all the rituals and things like that. You know, take it or leave it. For me, I leave that all, I set it all down. It means nothing to me. The only thing that means anything to me about her life was the perfect student role. Perfect humility of the perfect student and being absolutely blissful at all times, you know, no matter what we did, you're just so happy about everything. So that is crucial. And all the rest of the accoutrement, of the, whatever happened, forget it. I'm not interested in that. But with this 30-year jubilee anniversary kind of coming up, I'm thinking, hey, wait a minute. I feel there's something brewing here. There's something brewing. And suddenly this whole situation of the right juxtaposition of teacher and student came into light, and suddenly I saw what her role really was. The whole thing just, boom, clarified. I say, my gosh, you know, we really could have a situation arise for us in this world where the perfect student shows up. We really can. We deserve it. We deserve it. Because that is the highest opportunity for us. And we deserve the highest opportunity. Why? Because we're doing the work, right? Watching these videos is work. It is a lot of work. And yet we're doing the work. And by doing this work, we are preparing ourselves to avail ourselves of the highest opportunity. And we welcome the perfect student into our classroom and say, you know, have a seat. Welcome. And then we just be very quiet and assess the situation, okay? See, it's a great opportunity for us. Those who have prepared have always said, prepare, 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 prepare. Something is going to show up here in this world. I've always been 100% convinced of that. Something is going to show up here in this world to help us during this most dire time that we're in. Because if you look at the world, I don't even look at the world now. It is so, the direction that it's going in is so terrible that I don't even want to look at it anymore. And I'm getting a phone call right now. So very great. I'm happy to share this video with you. Continue your preparation. Continue to prepare for some positive opportunity. And again, I would say the highest opportunity would be a perfect student showing up. But even so, you can get this whole thing right in your mind that you are the teacher. You are the teacher. And you can choose a perfect curriculum. And you will do that. And why not do it now? All right. Very great. That's it for this video.